IVM.
कृपया ध्यान दीजिए, the language used on the podcast may not be fit for consumption. We warn you, tread carefully. But listen, yaar, don't be so conservative.
It's time for Cock and Bull on a fresh Monday morning, with the rain just having stopped, sort of, where I am here in Fountain, with nothing open. I want to thank the Maharashtra government for once again keeping us at level 3. Far-seeing and great move, so that commerce will completely come to a standstill, even though numbers are dropping. But I guess their point is that we want to make sure it doesn't ever go back to level 3. That's what we said the last time. Anyway, my points remain my points. I don't want to push it down people's throats because I sound like some kind of rebel cowboy from Donald Trump's family. Let's move on to a story that I want to share quickly before I bring in everybody. Everybody means two people. My daughter, who is now the philosopher who I trust with everything, gave me a factoid saying that elephants are the only animals. Listen to this. Elephants are the only animals in the entire world that can't jump. Now, this is what irritates me. When people in forums do these surveys, they don't check every their facts properly. They haven't. Because I can tell you that not only elephants, but my friend Kunal Vijaykar cannot jump. I've never seen him jump. He cannot. His feet have never left the floor. Even when someone is cleaning the floor in his house, they have to pick up the foot themselves and then clean under it. He can't jump. He cannot jump. Anyway, another factor she gave me, but I won't waste time on it, is Coca-Cola was initially green.
Hi, I'm Zarina Poonawalla, host of the Empowering Series podcast on the IVM Network. I happen to be a peak performance coach and leadership coach by profession, and I'm here to share with you productivity tools, life-altering techniques, and real-life hacks to help you achieve your maximum potential in everything you do, your relationships, professions, careers. So tune in every Monday to unleash your inner power. Be safe. Be well, be empowered.
I want to discuss that with this eminent panel. Let's introduce. This apparently is true, Amit Doshi and Silvery. Coca-Cola, when it first came out, was green. It's like racism, you know, in a sense.
Really. I can see that.
Yeah, it was green. It was a cough drop or something. Initially, it was a medication. Was the intent or something, was it not?
So it was medication, and it was made of basically cocoa leaves and cocaine.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. I'm not joking.
And the FDA was like, what the hell? Color it green and sell it. Yeah.
No, it was just cocaine, man. I mean, like, it was a cocaine drink. Cocaine was not considered, cocaine was considered to be good for your health.
That's why when they came up with Coca-Cola Classic, they always wink. The model winks at camera. Coca-Cola Classic.
It was also discovered by accident, Coca-Cola.
Like know. Most great things, almost everything, yeah. Including children, the ones that achieve a lot of things were accidents. You know, the ones they plan, the babies are terrible. They do nothing with their life.
How accident though? What's the story there?
The carbonated water was mixed by mistake. It was supposed to be just regular water, but carbonated water just made like a wonder, and then that's what made it.
No, but seltzer has been around for a while before Coca-Cola started. Seltzer water isn't like soda water, right?
Yeah, exactly.
No, but the point was not to put the seltzer water in. By mistake, somebody put it in. They didn't follow the exact formula of what they were trying to make.
Exactly.
So what he's saying is that by mix and match, a cocktail happened, which wasn't the intent on paper. And then they said, what the hell, they liked it or whatever. But it was green. Initially, it was green, which just tells you the colors of the rainbow, bro. Everything don't have to be anything. All of us are the same. What is the greatest black drink in the world was actually a green drink once. Like you never know. You know, you find out that Hitler was 10% Jew. If you do the DNA testing and all that, you know, all these morons of the world, anti-Muslim guys who probably have Muslim blood, Hindu guys who have Muslim guys have Hindu blood. You know, I mean, it's nonsense. The fact of the matter is, if there is a God, he must be laughing. You don't know the truth.
So if everybody in the world is descended from that one woman, no? That's one woman who we've all been able to trace our descendancy to, who was basically this Africa kind of this, right? Basically coming out.
I was going to go with Mrs. Parekh from opposite because she's the oldest person in my lane. But obviously, your research is a little outdating me.
My research is a little like older. It's like maybe
decades above that.
Like maybe a few more than a few decades above that. But I think I remember reading that somewhere that I think she's called Mary or something like that now at this point.
They've given her a generic name. And to be all descendants from the one DNA.
She's supposed to be the mother of us all, or at least like a big chunk.
But then how did the child, not to get into the entire Christian thing, but how was the conception?
She was not the first. There were more humans than her at that point in time. But she was, so actually, I don't think it's all right. So it's basically, she was part of the group that left Africa to travel through.
The ones who migrated.
Right, exactly. And she was one of the
they
first.
They come from one DNA, the ones that left Africa. Now that makes sense. Correct. Mary was unhappy with the distribution of land. She got only 3 cows instead of 4, was very angry, and decided to start her own country. So she moved west of Africa and landed in what is now Egypt and started the mummification of that country. Just bury the buggers dead or alive and, you know, put all the servants with them. I hate that concept. Imagine if you're the slave of a leader and when you hope he lives, you're always, sir, how are you feeling? Every day you come home, take the temperature.
That's how you engender loyalty. No, I die, you die.
Can you imagine? I die. The 19-year-old guy is about to just here for 3 days. You know what I mean? Like, you know, my job was to open doors and now I'm going to be stuck inside.
So some of the stuff is like really insane, right? So over the weekend, I was watching a documentary on the advent of Rome, right? Basically, the various ways that Rome kind of advanced, right?
Romulus and Remus.
So Romulus and Remus, and then like, you know, the Scipio family who conquered Carthage, and then the ones who conquered like this. And I was just like this. Did the degree to which they took superstition seriously, right? Like, I mean, like, you know, we, the word the auguries is something we've heard, right? You've heard about the auguries as like, a way of telling the future and this and that. But then this is the first time I ever kind of saw something which was telling me how they did the auguries, right? And so basically what they had is it was basically what is...
Animal sacrifice.
So it's animal sacrifice, but you have to read the liver of the animal. And what you do with the liver is they have these kinds of standardized liver templates made. Right, which are made in metal or something like that, which tell you exactly what the size of the different parts of the liver are supposed to be. And when certain parts are larger or certain parts are smaller than expected, that is on the basis of which they make their decisions about what there is. And so each section of the liver is dedicated to a different god or goddess. So there's an aspect of war on one part of it. There's an aspect of speed on one part of it. And I was just like, wow, this is like, you know, so I mean, like, you know, this is not just like, let's kill some animals and make some shit up, right? This is actually like, you know, there was a tremendous amount of thought given into how they went about doing this. I thought it was really fascinating.
Yeah, also some mediocre scientists who hated animals came up with the idea somewhere down the line because he couldn't invent anything and out of frustration. Said, okay, you know what? Let's kill an animal, take out a liver, and I'll read it to you and I'll tell you what's going to happen. And the next thing you know, he's the biggest guy in town. They're like, oh, I want to start a business. I've got to check with you. It's still there till today, Amit Doshi. And I know you don't like this practice at all because all your pet peeves come from, are born perhaps from these cultures and our own, of course, astrology, astronomy, everything, you know, all the oracles and all the occult traditions of predicting and looking forward and looking into bowls. Some of them just look so infantile. Now, why do you look into a bowl, for God's sake? I mean, as an adult male having a conversation with another adult woman or whatever, and she says, look, your future's in this bowl. I'm like, what? I mean, I went MBA from Harvard, you know, I worked 17 years in banking, you know, what the hell? And all you look into a small bowl and tell me that my next child will be born with 3 legs.
It's just so much nonsense, right? Isn't it? It's just, it's, but the thing is, it all does come from like a sense of there was some thought given to this at some point in time, but we know better now.
But let us Stacey it. What's your take on taking the slippers off? And these are big shots to do it. I mean, including people I know very close to me, etc. Walking to a Siddhi Vinayak or a Tirupati or whatever without shoes for hours and hours, for miles and miles.
Listen, people with religious people are delusional. What can you say? You know that...
And you know, poor people on the road looking at the rich person with the Mercedes is following behind and going in first gear while the guy walks because for protection, his 20 bodyguards and all will be there. I'm like, but what's with that, man? Why do you have to walk? You made all that money, so you don't have to walk.
You know the Jain thing, right? About when you're supposed to go to temple every day, you're supposed to go without shoes.
Correct.
Right? That's supposed to be a thing.
Are you supposed to go from the house?
Yeah, from your house. So that's why a lot of the most expensive buildings in our areas are the ones directly opposite Jain temples.
Or they build one mandir there for safety. Who the hell wants to go, you know, to Kandivali West from Malabar Hill with no slippers?
Chandanbala Temple, the main temple on the big temple on the main road, the temple at Sripalnagar, right? Like these are Jain temples, but the buildings right across them are extraordinarily expensive.
If you want to balance out your karma, instead of taking on this fabulous, you know, sort of self, what's the right word, you know, self-sacrifice, if you may, and you walk from, say, Andheri to Prabhadevi in hot sun, you know, with nothing under your feet, why can't you just donate to a charity or look after, say, some children or help build a hospital? There are many ways you can also get good karma, you know?
I agree, 100%.
Why do you have to walk? No, I'm not talking so much about the superstition as much as the intellectual capacity of the person to accept that as the option.
So I think
I don't mind a little superstition. My point is, but it's a little juvenile.
I think you don't want to put all your eggs in one basket. So like, I'll do a little bit of this, I'll do a little bit of that, I'll get goodwill from everywhere.
That's a great point.
It's cumulative effect.
The all round, the holistic karma theory. Main sab kuch karunga. Why take a chance? Yeah, God. Anyway, the good thing is at least you're born here, not in ancient Egypt, where if you were a servant to a rich person, you'd have to go and
just straight in.
Straight in, there's no question. And you have to take his name and say good things as they bury you. You know, your last words will be, yes, by Osiris, Intipata was a very good man. You're never seen again.
Okay.
Wow. Although I can think of a few help that I have, which I don't mind bearing, but let's not say that. Okay, folks, let's get on with this great show. That's yes, two cock and bulls in a row. We haven't been able to find a guest. So if you're a guest and you think you're suitable for this show, which takes intellectual stimulation to another level from a different perspective, and if you feel that this is the place for you, write into Silvery or email Silvery on silvery.com.
Sure.
I shag sheep. I don't know. What is the poster? What would be, I don't know, the appropriate email, Silvery, that your parents don't know?
No, that one's correct. You got spot on. Spot on, sir. That was correct.
Smart Alec. I'm the senior. You have to call me bhai. Oh, Saras bhai. Come on, let's not in fire a bit. Oh, Saras bhai. Yeah, le, what's going on? What do we have? What's the first one, yaar?
Asa, pehla topic. Pehla topic.
Haji. Haji. Okay. You see, Amit, you learn how to be part of the flavor, yaar. Oh, by the way, guys, sorry. Silvi, before you start, Amit is doing this under great duress. He's had a horrible toothache for the last 3 days and he's in a lot of pain. He's taken, what's the medication you've taken?
Flexon,
which is basically for pregnant women to ease the muscle in their inner thighs when they're delivering. For some reason, the cheap dentist said, this is the one for you, because it's lying on his wife's bedside. So he said, what the hell am I doing?
Not a cheap dentist.
I touched the Gujarati in you right now, didn't I? It's not about making fun of the dentist. It's about, dare you call him cheap. You bore the pain for 48 hours rather than go there and take that bill, which is another pain of another kind. Yeah. Why do they charge so much, man? I just don't get healing and charging. You know, I just don't get it. It sounds morally wrong.
It's it's not morally wrong, right? I mean, like, these are people providing a service which you require.
As a capitalist, I'm saying any society has to, it's like the NHS or whatever. You've got to have the government has to play ball in this.
Well, so there are government hospitals which are available to you, right? You just choose not to use them.
Yes, but have you been to them recently? Or recently you choose them up a little bit, yeah.
That's why you choose not to use them, right? I mean, like, it's difficult, right? I mean, like, the healthcare, how do you... So if you're a doctor, right, it takes a lot of effort, it takes a lot of time, it takes a lot of work to become a doctor. And I would not be happy if I was a doctor and I was told that we're going to tell you how much money you can make. Nobody else has any, you have no say in it, right? I wouldn't be happy with that.
No, I'm not saying that.
So, I mean, like,
they should charge. I'm saying that some of that money for the charge is, and they should charge according to reputation and name. That's also fair. But some of the money should be supplemented by the government. I just feel it should. Like for all citizens.
It should, right? But again,
including the ones who go to Baba Devi, Siddhi Vinayak without chappals because they're very rich.
So, here's the question, right? I mean, like, I was talking to a friend of mine who's in the insurance business about this, right? That why do we not have dental insurance? Because, dude, I spent some money on this dentistry stuff, right, over the last couple of years. And I was like, why don't we have dentistry insurance? Why don't we have dental insurance like they do in the US? Because I spend almost no money on like actual healthcare, but on dental stuff I spend mad money. And he's just like, because you won't want to pay the premiums that would be applicable for dental insurance. If you want to get...
Also, when you die, your smile will look great. I mean, there's a positive in all that.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, but you're right.
Yeah, you don't want to pay the premiums, right? If you want to get dental insurance done in India, right, from a good
dentist. What are the premiums like? Give me an idea.
Yeah, I mean, like, you'd be looking at something like 60,000, 70,000 bucks a year.
Ah, I mean, for you, what is it? 60,000, 70,000 bucks. But then I get your point.
It's a lot.
If it's a standard rate, people won't be able to afford it.
Yeah.
It has to be up and down.
No, and...
Well, let me put Silvery onto this. He'll solve it. Silvery, you have to find a sort of holistic number which everyone can live with. Or if you're doing like a tax situation where you go up or down depending on the society's ability to earn money, then that also should be sort of fair. Because if it's like 1% of my income, it should be 1% of Raju's income. By Raju, there are lots of rich Rajus also. I'm just taking a generic name. If you'd like me to take another name, Rahim. Again, lots of rich Rahims. I'll take a third name. Rocky. Rocky is good. Rocky is safe.
Okay.
Rocky is good. Silvery, over to you, sir.
So a number for me, 100 million, maybe? Dollars?
On health.
That's enough.
On premiums.
Are you talking about?
For insurance.
Premiums for what? Sorry.
So you don't have to pay when you actually get it.
Oh, sorry.
If you don't pay attention to the show, what do we expect anybody else to do? I mean, you're in the show. Look at the quality of the show, man. Just look at it. It just speaks for itself. Out of three, 33% don't even care about their own show, which they're in. They're inside the show and not, you know what I mean? How can you be inside the show? And
I don't understand what context led you to a $100 million number, because there's nothing that we could have been talking about that led to that number.
Phone. I want to expose this kid. He's watching porn all the time. He sees two ugly middle-aged men and he's lost interest. When we have a girl on the show, he's very interested. It changes completely. The man is prejudiced. I'm telling you. It's only you and me who are treated with disdain. He's on some freaking midgets from Germany. One of his favorite. Again, I apologize to anybody who. But these are the titles that I've seen. It's not mine to give. Oh, sorry.
Yeah, I heard that. So I just ask, how much money would you need in your entire life so that you don't have to work ever? Like, so something similar to that.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Ah, okay. All right.
Ambitious young man.
What you need is Cyrus Brocha's net worth, right? You know what you get from Google? That's what you need.
Yeah, from Google, it's $100 million. Yeah. Oh, what is it? I forgot.
For me, Google has been 80% fiction, especially when trying to find small studios in Jogeshwari, you know, and they go into the lane opposite. And you're literally there 15 minutes before you realize it's the other lane. But it clearly says take a left and not a right. These are mistakes which are very odd for me. Unless they thought there was a back lane, in which case the left became a right, which there may have been, I don't know. But how do you access that?
So I think a lot of the problem right now is that roads are just opening and shutting during the pandemic and we're not out all the time, so we don't know them, right?
Google can't keep up with maintenance in India. Let's face it. PwC in India, fucks Google. Sorry to use bad language.
Where did I go? I went to Babulnath the other day, and apparently right now, the Chopati to Babulnath Road is shut from 2 p.m. and it's open and from 2 p.m. Morning till 2 p.m. it's only from Babulnath to Chopati. That road is a one way. I didn't know.
That's where the kids' school is, right there.
Yeah.
So they better let them out under 2 if there was school. But of course, there isn't school. But there is school, but it's online. Whatever. Just like our show.
No, but I mean, like, I think all of that, right? In my building, like, you know, the way to come to my building has been shut 3 different times in the last 6 months. Once you had to come from this way, once you had to come from this way, once you had to come from this way, you know, they're just shutting down different roads. They're doing them. Hopefully, you know, by the time we get out of pandemic, we'll have a much better
what a funny thing to say.
Road situations.
Right. Yeah, it'll all be ready.
Get out of pandemic.
And then they wait for the chief guest. That's another big deal.
Are you laughing at the idea of getting out of pandemic itself?
No, I'm laughing at the idea of PwC ever doing anything properly.
Roads never getting better.
This never ends. It just never ends. It never will end.
Yeah, that is true.
I'm too cynical about that. Please, as a self-driver and a self-pedestrian or whatever, that doesn't make sense, but as a pedestrian also, it's just horrible. And South Bombay just looks like it's been hit by bombs all the time, man.
Yeah, I know, man.
You know, there's a hole, you know, hole there. In our lane, the trees fell and the holes are still there. There's no new trees, which were promised about 2 weeks ago. They haven't come yet.
It's just there, man. I mean, like, the stuff's just not moving. It's crazy.
I want to just take 5-6 of the most anxious and scared and paranoid neighbors and put them in that hole. In which case, you know, 2 birds with 1 stone that covers the hole and, you know, we get rid of them and their fear. Sensitive Cyrus here. Let's go back to Silvery. Silvery, let's get on. We had some nice topics, man. Where have I written mine?
Sure. Yeah, we have some great topics.
Have you humanitarian of the year so far? Is that Dilip Lande? Yes, that's his name. Lande, L-A-N-D-E. That's the name.
Yeah, we can start with Dilip Lande first then. So
what's his name?
Dilip Lande.
Okay.
Lande? Okay, Lande.
Watch it. Don't be insulting, but okay, just seeing the name does sound a little funny. Yeah.
Land.
Dilip part.
Let's just call him Land.
Yeah. Okay, so talk about Dilip Aji for 1 minute, please.
Yes. So Dilip Lande is a Shiv Sena MLA. And I'm just going to play this video.
Yeah, this video has to be seen by the world.
Yeah. Can you guys see this?
Yeah, we can see it.
All right. So basically, Dilip Lande, Shiv Sena MLA, he got a hold. Oh, by the way, he's from Chandivali. Chandivali is my area where I stay. So apparently, he got.
Were you part of the group? The mob?
No, I was.
So he's your MLA.
Yeah, he's my MLA. I don't even know who he is.
Your MLA.
Yeah.
And whether it's Lande or water, he's always there. Go.
Yeah, exactly. So he basically, there was some water logging in the area. And he got a hold of one of the BMC workers who was in charge of this water logging.
You know, not even the top class, just a guy who's actually doing things. Sorry.
Oh, wait, so it was an operations guy. It wasn't even like the officer.
Operations guy, bro. It's like taking the spot boy on a set and beating him up for the shoot happening and not the producer.
It says he was a contractor, though. The guy who was made to sit.
They're all contractors, but he's low level, bro. Look, you watch. Just watch the video. Show the video.
Yeah, I'm going to go ahead. Yeah. So see this? This is Dilip Lande.
Also, we have most people listening to us on audio. So we have to describe. So he's pushing an engineer.
No, he's pushed him onto the wet floor with pouring rain. And this is complete assault. Excuse me, this is not less than assault.
He should be in jail. He should be, no doubt.
And he's standing there like a crusader, thinking he's done great work. I, on one hand, of course, get very irritated when the work is not done. We've just discussed that. No, but how dare you do this?
He's making his own workers put garbage on him. He's forcing his own workers to drop garbage on him, man.
On this guy, to humiliate him.
Man, that is...
Yeah, it's ridiculous.
What's amazing is that for once, they couldn't find too much garbage. They're doing their best. But for a city filled with garbage, they were having little trouble finding it. That's quite okay. Obviously, nobody's interested in my point. But, I mean, you seem shell-shocked, like you live in another country.
I'm just, I'm amazed, right? I mean, like, this happened in Antariksh is MLA.
Yep, exactly.
And stop pointing fingers at Jharkhand, Bihar, UP and saying only violence happens there, Haryana, as the 4 or 5 bad states of India. We have some horrible elements across the length and breadth of our country, which we should be proud of, like Dilip Bhai here. You know, yeah. I mean, just look at the humiliation and the stupidity of it. And he had already told him to call the boss and the hierarchy and the boss above that boss and everything, you know, to show his weight and power. Yeah, go on.
Yeah, he said, we will stop putting dumping garbage on you when your boss shows up. I'm like, are you crazy when you say that? Yeah.
They will recycle and put the garbage on the boss. That was the idea.
No, but I'm just like, how is this guy walking around? He should be in jail.
That's what I'm saying. This is assault. Absolutely. You saw. I mean, those who can't see, those who just are having the audio feed here, he was pushed down onto the floor. He's crapping his pants because he's got the 40 of the supporters there against him. And they're all, you know, testosterone is rampant. Everybody's screaming and shouting. And then they decide to throw garbage on him. Well, he sits there. I mean, how humiliating is that? I mean, who does that to another human being? I'd rather much prefer we punch him in the face and, you know, they just got into a fist fight and ended it. I mean, there's some dignity in that, but this is ridiculous.
It's actually very possible that they actually did a little bit of violence. They probably shoved him. They probably like pushed him. So he pushed him onto the ground, right?
Yeah. They are showing you what they think is the just deserts punishment to show that the law has taken its course and all. While fundamentally, they are right to fight against the contractors. Keep in mind, Shiv Sena only owned the BMC. At least up to this coming election, and Shiv Sena only are responsible.
Exactly.
So I don't get it. It's like me slapping my son.
Criticizing his own party.
This is a contractor. He's an external party. It's just the but again, I don't want to make it sound like I'm making excuses, right? This is an outside company or someone like that whose job it is to do this.
That is just the process that they follow. I mean, what's the point of that? At the end of the day, if I use a freelancer as a vendor and I shoot a film or do a podcast, they're still part of the whole deal, no?
He's part of the team, exactly, yeah. No, there's no excuse for this, right? What possible excuse can there possibly be for someone?
Who does this? How can you come to leadership when you behave like this? Would you ever do this to anyone?
How can you come to leadership in India if you do not behave like this?
Yeah, right. Sorry, oh God, really. I stand corrected. Absolutely spot on, yeah.
Oof. We all know what will happen in the next 2 days. Because it went viral online, this guy will apologize. Oh, I didn't mean to do it that way. I meant it in this regard. And then nothing will happen. This guy won't
even apologize. He'll disappear. He'll be asked to stay out of the publicity ring for a little while.
Maybe.
And he'll just disappear. Yeah. And somebody else will say, you know, this is a loan incident. You don't know what happened before. They'll disguise it and, you know, all that.
Yeah.
And just push it under the table. What about the humiliation of that young man? You know, I mean, how dare he be disrespected in that manner? In any proper democracy, there's no question that action would have been taken. I mean, imagine in Sweden this happening, for example. Let's look at the high countries in terms of morality and ethics. Go to a Scandinavian country and tell me if this could ever happen. If, oh my God. I mean, just ridiculous.
It's not even that, right? I mean, like, why do you even have to look at that? You can just look at anybody's, any developed country. You can't see this kind of shit happen anywhere, right? I mean, like, why Scandinavia? Why? It should not happen here, right? I mean, like, to say that, you know, that we are a country that's backward and to kind of say that this is
I have an internal rift here, which is that my track is slightly different. We Mumbaikers go on pointing fingers at North Indians and saying all the crap happened. My friend Kunal, all the time, the Biharis, the UPIs, this kind of racism, regionalism that he propagates and others propagate, not knowing that after some time, that it's not that much different. Maharashtra is not that much different. Why are we saying all this? Don't think three states in India are responsible for all the violence and atrocities and savage medieval sort of attitudes. It's this whole medieval backward attitude that we're really looking at more than anything else. My God, no. It happens in the South. It happens in the East. It happens here.
So I think the fundamental issue, right, is the idea that the people who we elect, right, do they work for the public or does the public work for them? Who answers to who here, right? And the thing is that India is a very feudally driven society historically, right? In the sense that, you know, I mean, like if anybody talks, if you talk to somebody who comes from a smaller village, right? They have to go back for elections. It doesn't matter what. They have to go back for elections because the person who is the MLA from that particular area is the person who is there, like, you know, he basically takes care of all their shit, or at least the perception is he takes care of all their stuff, right? So when he says, come back and vote for the elections, you go back and vote for the elections. So, you know, it's just it's this feudalism aspect, right? It's this idea that our MLAs or our MPs or our ministers or whatever, right, are basically part not of a democracy, or at least they are part of a democracy in some senses, but we treat them as if they are our feudal lords.
We can't say for sure, but let's look at what could have happened before. In the area, in Silvery's area, Silvery's family and others have called up their local MLA and or the people who are close to the MLA and absolutely, you know, went after, berated the guy and said, look, boss, ye kab se hua? Abhi kuch nahi hua, kitna din se complain marte hum log, kuch nahi hua, and etc. etc. And let's say a few days have passed. So there's a graph where the guy is going, he's probably warned the guy or whatever a couple of times, and then finally he comes and he does that. Even then, now he had the moral right up to then in a sense saying that, you know, boss, what's happening? A, it's his own system, which is in place, they're in power, they're also in power in the BMC. B, it's a humanity thing after some point. You just don't behave like this. It punishment and the crime are just gone out of the window. Nobody behaves like that.
How do you treat people like that? How do you think you can treat people like that, right? I mean, like, they're people. How can you treat people like that? It's just insane.
The Kasab, when he was caught, was not ill-treated in this manner. I mean, that's the highest of high crimes I can think of. You know, I mean, really? I mean, sometimes you have to look at the BMC's side of things as well. Maybe they're, you know, they didn't have enough people that day. Maybe the cyclone before that had stopped them.
It's inexcusable that this kind of flooding has happened. It's inexcusable that this kind of violence happened.
Everyone has a right to their opinion. And it has to, we have to have a civil society where a legal process is followed. Due process is followed. I'm saying, how do we know? We don't know 100%. What you're saying is 90% correct. We're all angry with them. They're always, you know, whenever monsoon comes. We're going to show quick another one before we go into break as well, where we'll definitely be on the side of weather-beaten Mumbaikers once again, year after year after year in Ghatkopar. We can go into that, in fact, Silvery, which is in Ghatkopar. A car basically, Amit, went. Okay, just take a look. But we'll have to explain it for those who can't see. And when I say can't see again, I don't mean...
You're not necessarily that they're blind, but they're just consuming us over audio.
And not that that's a bad thing either. Oh my God.
So, yeah.
Oh, apologize to everyone at the beginning. Yeah, go ahead.
This is a car in Ghatkopar. Just entered a sink, just drowned in a sinkhole.
I mean, it's like a video game. For those who can't, I'm so sorry because it's a loss of valuables. It's like a bad video game from the 90s or 80s when Amit was a young man. I'm so sorry. I really should. So, I'm so sorry. This is wrong. We shouldn't laugh.
But then you'll play it again.
For those who can't see the visual, it looks like a pretty big car. I can't quite tell which car it is. And it basically,
it's basically a Hyundai Creta.
Creta, which is not exactly
a Creta. I think it's the venue. It looks too small for a Creta.
Okay, guys, let's not give the brand. We can't tell. But it actually sank, for those who can't
see. You can see the age for Hyundai. Age, you can see.
All right, I think that's the least of the issues. I'm glad the two of you want to sit here and fight over whether it's a Hyundai or a Maruti or whatever. I'm glad that's what we're getting out of it.
It's not Hyundai's fault, no. It's not as if you expect Hyundai to make clothing cars.
Yeah, correct.
Leave Hyundai alone. Let's get back to the point here. Again, for those who didn't see, the car basically submerges in seconds. It's really, for me, like a video game. It actually was there. Then in a few seconds, you see it. I mean, it's surreal. And then it just sort of disappears. And I'm sorry. I apologize for laughing. It's very insensitive. But it just, I mean, how? When we're looking at Beijing, India, Mumbai becoming like Shanghai and this and that. And you see these pictures and you think, my God.
For this one, though, at least they have a good enough explanation.
Which is?
That it's not in the BMC's fault.
Underground parking.
No. This was, So under that area, there was a well that they had basically put a slab over, and that was all they had done. And they like covered the...
Who put the slab over the building while building?
No, the locals in the area, in Ghatkopar, in that area. That's what the article says. So because of the rains, that land underneath...
A civic body has to do it, or the builder has to do it. Who, what local can do it?
Yeah, you're right, actually.
It must be the builder only. No? It's a parking lot. It's a parking lot.
Yeah, there's got to be a matlabi reason. Now, why would you do it? Sorry, go on.
Yeah, so because of the rains, that slab thing became very soft, and that's what it gave way, and the car was right on top of it. And that's why it just...
That's not a reason. That's not a reason. They had a well which they covered, and then the car went into the well. And what's your reaction? Ah, well.
Yeah, that's true. You're right.
So now we are almost on Dilip Lande's side, because now we see the other side of it. We're laughing, but if it was my car, trust me, whenever my car's been hit by a coconut, and on another occasion, a tree fell on another car years before, and I was in tears, okay? I was in tears because it's like bad karma. You start, you know, all kinds of things over your mind. What the hell? This guy parks his car. He goes to watch the Euro Cup. And in 20 minutes, at halftime, he looks out of the window. His car is drowned. His car has drowned. Okay, 21st century India, here we come. If your car is round, Kripaya Dhyan Dijiye, call this number, LN2-177-3-FAR-FAR. Call Urvashi. What the fuck, man? Your car is... I'm sorry, it's the funniest thing I've seen in a long time. I got it. I mean, in a dark way. Oh, boy, we'll have to apologize to car manufacturers and everything. Big Hyundai fan myself. But what the hell?
I don't know.
Amit, any reaction? We have to go to break. It's 10:31.
No, I mean, it's... again, you know, I mean, like I said, the BMC, right? I mean, like, they're not exactly the best in terms of, you know, just generally making sure the city's well run, right? I mean, like, this is a BMC thing, right? I mean, like, there should be an inspection when you're building a parking lot. So, I mean, like, what are you going to say? It's just...
Can you imagine just coming out of the restaurant wherever you're gone and see, like, dude, I'm sure I parked my car here somewhere. Yeah, like, what?
Where's my car? And then you see this massive puddle, right? And you can't see underneath it because it's so dark, right? And so you're just like...
Yeah.
But the lesson here that has to be learned is, if you're in Ghatkopar at a dealership, always ask if your car is waterproof before you buy. These are essential questions nobody's asking. We'll take a break, and I will be back after this break.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to another great week on the IVM Podcast Network. If you're not following us on social media, please do. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. I'd like to thank the sponsor of the network this week, Cred and Sia. Thank you so much for making this possible. On Cyrus Says, Cyrus was joined by actress Shreya Pilgaonkar to talk about her career in acting. On Begin the Journey, Ashish Vidyarthi lists down the modern concepts of friendship and how one can choose the right friend circle in life on Begin the Journey. On The Habit Coach, Ashton Doctor was joined by Aisha Bilimoria to talk about running and developing an athletic mentality. Farhad and Sunetra are joined by LGBTQ workplace advocate Suresh Ramdas to discuss the new normal in queer relationships on KBCD. On Tere Mere Raaste, Keshav Chaturvedi takes us to the riverbanks of Banaras and describes the soulful mornings to us. And finally, on the Positively Unlimited podcast, Chetna Chakravarti takes the fear out of the word responsibility. And with that, let's get you back to your show.
Follow me at Instagram and Twitter on Bored Brocha. I'm so bored, I need your help. I need your love. I need your touch. Okay, just follow me.
But last word on the subject, we haven't even been able to get to anything. Monsoon mayhem, I'm in the media, I work in TV stations, so I sort of know. They just love it. It's almost a glee. And Mumbai is like Donald Trump. It doesn't fail to disappoint, you know. I don't know, every year. I mean, how many years? I mean, it's not even funny anymore. It's like we're just waiting. Okay, now let's have some fun. What should we write about in our skits and all that? We know we've got a whole monsoon quota now. Just like we had, you know, this quarantine quota, et cetera, et cetera. This is there.
Yeah, there's bound to be one set of flooding. All of the journalists already have their articles ready about the spirit of Mumbai.
Yeah, spirit of Mumbai. Oh, God, don't start that crap.
So all of that stuff is all ready. Nah? It's already ready.
We should drown the spirit of Mumbai with that car. You know, this crap about spirit of Mumbai. Talk to the person who lost 10 lakhs on that car. You know, and talk to the people who lost their lives in those two building collapses. You know, the landslides and all that. You know, it's all shoddy work and bad, the inability to deal with the monsoon. It all comes together. Let's not face it.
That only, no. I mean, that's the number one problem we have. Why do we have to make roads every year? Because we don't know how to make roads that will last more than a couple of months, more than a monsoon, a single monsoon.
Of course, there's a theory that's purposely done, janbujhke, as we...
I think it's the theory. I think it's obvious.
So in the sense that, because you make... PW makes more money the more times they can work. Yeah. The more vendors are involved, the more kickbacks are involved. Yeah. If you want to be negative, that just makes sense. That just absolutely makes sense to not have a Singapore. You don't want to do something and not touch it for 40 years. That's horrible. Look at Singapore. There's no bribery. There's no money to be made. That's your salary and that's your life.
If you are a vendor, why would you do high quality work when low quality work is what is being required of you?
Because you've got three jobs instead of one job every year. I mean, it makes sense, right? I've got three clients out of one client, for example. Just do the maths. But the thing is, because no one, what is their conscience? Because ultimately people die, people loss of life, the loss of valuables, the loss of all kinds of things. I mean, that accountability is not really, it doesn't come into the fore in the end. It gets buried in the quagmire of all this bureaucracy. Who's responsible? Finger pointing. The engineer, he's not there. The locals moved the well. This one ordered it. That person is dead now. You know, I mean, in all that, it gets sort of buried.
Yeah, like how often have you come across like 1 month they made, like remade the road, and the very next month it is just spoiled right again? It happens all the time. Like in my area, just recently, like 2 months back, they remade our entrance road to our colony. And again, already it is showing like cracks and all. There's like a puddle which is already forming there. It is ridiculous. Yeah.
The other thing I never understood, right, is why does all of this work have to end in the month of May?
It doesn't end in May. It's still actually not ended. They're saying it's ended. Hence, the work is this shoddy. No? They don't really complete it. They complete under pressure because the inability. The efficiency is the one thing is efficiency. The second question, is it efficiency with malice or efficiency just inefficiency?
So
those are two different.
That's right. So I generally prescribe to the don't imbue malice where, like, you know, incompetence is enough. Right?
Yeah, we don't have proof mostly, so fair enough.
Yeah, so I generally believe that, you know, incompetence is more than sufficient to cause these kinds of issues, right? But this is not incompetence, right? Because again, this is like, you know, it's by design, it's by been put like this. And maybe it might have been designed like this years ago, but nobody's changed it, right? Why is the
infrastructure of Mumbai is just not able to take on all the buildings and the resurfacing that we are doing. I'm telling you, just find a place and just go there now. We're just too many of us, 22 million people with all their worldly possessions, and they're just killing the surface. So much so that this poor man living in Powai now has Lake Powai at his doorstep, you know, where it was 100 yards away.
I don't think the population is the problem. Bombay is a big city geographically, right? Because when you're talking about 25 million, you're talking about Greater Mumbai. You're not talking about just Bombay. You're talking about Thane. You're talking about New Bombay. You're talking about like...
It's a load the population is putting on everything.
It's not that high. It's not that high a population. Bombay is one of the biggest cities in the world, right? But considering the landmass it's spread out on and given what the future of the world is going to be, the future of the world is cities. The future of the world is not villages and towns, right? The future of the world is big cities because that's where maximum kind of value is being generated, generally speaking, right? Now, this pandemic kind of throws that into the air a little bit where people are thinking that, hey, you know, you don't necessarily need to be where you want to. But I don't buy that being this. I think that...
You look at the correlation between small cities with quality townships, less people, and you don't see all this happening too much. You won't have this happening, let's say, in Wellington, okay, which will have a smaller population. Oh, it's a largest city, but it's a very small population. So it's easy to control everything. But there's far more sense of discipline. I'm saying from us as well, you know, in terms of looking after our property, looking after the road, having an interest in the surface that you're living on. You know, the building tenants, etc., the people out there will all be playing a role, should have been playing a role.
I don't know if I buy that so much, right? I think that if you look at smaller cities in India, they're disasters, man. They're disasters, right? I mean, like, if you go to Nagpur, or if you go... Nagpur's not even really all that small.
It's not a small city.
Right? But I mean, like, it's still Nagpur.
Nagpur is very efficient right now. You've taken the wrong one. Yeah.
I've been to Agra. Agra, Amit is right about Agra.
Agra, what's your thinking on Agra?
I haven't been to Agra in many years.
Agra, very mismanaged.
Yeah, I like most of these cities are, right? I mean, like Ahmedabad, you know, I mean, like most of these cities are problematic as hell, right? And so I don't think... I
who are you blaming? The finger of accountability for you is on whom or who?
The population of India. We get the leaders we deserve, right? We get
point in a way. That's a point in a way. So what are you saying? We have to change the leaders by becoming leaders ourselves?
No, we have to change the leaders.
We have to show more interest in active politics and civic society?
Yeah, we have to show more interest in active society. And we need to stop giving a shit about national level politics. We need to really care about local politics because that's what really matters.
I agree with you. National level politics can take a flying, you know, we should only look at our locality. Just worry. Exactly.
Who gives a shit if in the budget the cost on the VAT or GST on steel is 2.1% or 2.2%. How does that affect anybody? It doesn't. But what does
my life is Churchgate to Parel. I am just concentrating on that. Occasionally, I have to go to Andheri. I'll suffer that. But I agree with you totally. Silvery, come to power.
Yeah.
With a name like Silvery, you will win everything. Of course, that means it just insinuates you're second place all the time. But what the hell? Second place is something. Look true. Where we are now. Oh. All right, shall we go to the AMAs or do we have time for one story or what? I think Monsoon is taking care of everything. So we'll have to save the other stories for another day.
All right, the AMAs. The first question comes in from Neo Kids. He says, Antariksh, given your name is Space, did you consider bidding for a seat with Jeff Bezos for 11 minutes space ride? How much were you short of the 28 million needed?
Who got it?
Yeah. I was short of only 1 million, man. I had 27 million ready to go. I was like, damn it, it's 28. I can't make it.
Then dad stepped in and said, no, beta, limit.
Yeah. correct. Don't waste that. You'll need that money later. But I would definitely want to go on a space ride, for sure. Why wouldn't you? Wouldn't you guys be interested in going on space ride?
Also, for me, it's elitism at its best. You know that only 17 people in the world can actually get into this auction. Some of this is ridiculous. You know, $28 million for a space ride. I mean, wow. Oof. And let's hope nothing, God forbid, happens to any of them. But who's...
Yeah.
What would be hilarious if is the only person who's with Jeff Bezos is Elon Musk in that flight. Because he's the only one who can afford it properly. So it's just the two space billionaires in space just roaming around.
But they haven't revealed the name, have they? Of the 28 million guest?
No, I don't think they have.
Think so.
I think I think the bidding and all is still going on, if I'm not wrong. Or it's about to start, something like that.
I think it was done. And that was the figure they came to, whoever the guest was bid at 28 million. Maybe it was Dilip Lande from the MLA from the earlier video. You know, it's got to be someone with money. 28 million. I mean, oof, ouch. Amit is checking online as we speak to make sure that checking. This podcast gives you award-breaking news information above anybody else. Don't put on a television set, for God's sake. We'll give it to you.
I know.
And as I speak, I'm elongating every sentence to give him time for his fat fingers to hit the keyboard. Yeah, with the toothache, it's difficult for him.
Unidentified bidder.
See, I told you. So it has to be an Indian. I have a few names. I won't mention any. But yeah, it has to be an
Indian. Adani.
What is 28 million? 28 million is...
Basically anyone in the Lok Sabha.
Like 175 crores, right?
I don't know. You do the maths. It's 7 crores into 100,000.
196 crores.
For a ride one way. Then they say, find your way back. Here's the parachute. Yeah. But what would be great if he goes into space, Jeff Bezos, he goes into space and then tests Amazon. He buys himself a little, you know, display or something. And he logs into Amazon and Amazon has to deliver. That would be a real test. Can they get through to space?
Sure.
Wow.
Okay.
Would you like to go to space, Amit? It's a little scary, no?
I'm not that interested. Not until it becomes as easy as taking a flight from Bombay to Delhi.
I'm worried about the peeing and stuff. Like if you take a crap or pee and then stuff just floats around. I mean, that's ridiculous. Your pee's everywhere. I mean, I don't know. How does that work?
But no, so that's exactly what happens, right? I mean, like you have to then spend time cleaning the shit up, right? I mean, like...
Literally. I mean, this is literal now. I mean, nobody talks literally like this. It's like a metaphor normally.
No, I mean, like I just...
The shit hits the fan. Yeah. Welcome to space, Peter.
I don't see the appeal, to be honest with you. I mean, like if it's... If space travel was... So you need to be one of two types of people, right? If you're a person who is really, really into the idea of space travel, you become an astronaut or what have you, right? Or you have to be Jeff Bezos, who has so much money that he's just looking for weird ass stuff.
Exactly, bro. It's these guys, they need their kicks. Now you get your kicks. You can buy any car, any plane. You've been to any country. You're treated like God everywhere you go, including India. Or maybe not China, but everywhere else. And then, you know, so you need a new kick. So there's a new kick. The poor guy, I mean, what is he?
Wouldn't you do it if it's more reasonably priced?
No. If I was super rich, would still not pay 28 million because that makes no sense.
28 million is, that's crazy. But
let's say you were super rich. Let's say you had $50 million in the bank, right? So $50 million is 350 crore rupees you have in the bank. How much would you pay?
50 lakhs.
I wouldn't pay a rupee until there was an airport at the spot where I need to go. Or if you're just basically taking a ride up and coming down to go see space, then maybe I'd pay some money.
If it doesn't titillate you enough, then why are you even having this conversation? No?
Yeah.
There's no point. Whether we have money or not, it's just not something that we want to do. You know, for me, I would rather see polar bears and find out if they're truly left-handed, which is another theory. All polar bears are left-handed. Is this true or not? I mean, there's so many.
Maya was wrong about the elephant thing. Huh?
Which other animal can jump?
Which other animal cannot jump?
Sorry, cannot jump.
Snails cannot jump.
Mammal. Okay, let's keep mammal then. Maybe it's mammal.
Okay, even in mammals, sloths cannot jump.
They can. They actually do a little jump.
Do they really? I don't think so.
They finally die with a jump. They commit suicide very often.
All right.
And I mentioned sloths anyway when I mentioned Kunal. So, hey, covered.
And do hippos jump?
Now, this is what titillates me and you. All right, those guys go to space. We are going into the savannah. We're going to find ourselves a hippo. And we're going to make the hippo jump.
Yeah, I don't know if a hippo jumps because a hippo is mostly in the water, right?
I'll tell you what. You have to go to a hippo, put your finger in his anus, and see his reaction. Okay? Just to tell you, the most number of humans killed in Africa are by hippos.
I know. It's the most,
so go ahead.
The most dangerous animal in the world.
It is the last thing you do.
Amit, you're right. It says hippos, they are incapable of jumping but do climb up steep banks. But they are incapable of jumping. Okay. That's what those says.
Take it back to Maya and I'll tell her. But until we clear this...
What about rhinos?
Okay. All right. Once he's got 10 fingers. So one finger in the hippo, one finger in the rhino. Okay? I'm 100 yards away in a jeep taking the photo. All right? Amit's going to do it. That's far as I'm concerned. Yeah. Man, bro, why can't Diet Coke sponsor our program? I mean, you're giving them so much.
I know, man. I give them so much publicity all the time.
And you do it in the subtle way also, which is the best way, the classiest way to do it till I, of course.
No, it's the way that they really like it.
Yeah, but any classy product would like that. And we're talking about whatever and Sip comes in 7 or 8 yes. times in a 1 hour thing and boom. Who can ask for more?
That is true.
And the colors are almost like a, you know, it's been done by a stylist.
It's, yeah, very unique. Color.
Unique. No, the color contrast, the blue of your shirt, you yes. know, the background which is white.
I pay attention to this stuff.
I'm not saying you don't. That's all I'm saying. I'm leaving that thought. Hang it out there. Let people grab it if they want to. Okay, let's get a couple more in, man. Silvery?
Yes. The next one comes in from S. Kumar. That's Sushil Kumar Saris, your favorite wrestler.
Before we go to Sushil Kumar, I want to ask him. The bug has got... Silvery, you tell me. He's got painkillers, yeah. The tooth is paining, and he's drinking Diet Coke. Now, is not Diet Coke not good for the teeth? Isn't that like proven?
I'm drinking something cold. I'm just keep sipping something cold.
And who's a hippo now? I mean, hypocrite, huh? Yeah. Sorry, go on. Sorry. Next one.
Okay, the next one comes in from S. Kumar.
Okay, so from S. Kumar, your thoughts on the Denmark-Finland match continued after a near death on the field.
Did you see what happened? I mean,
so I've kind of vaguely heard about this, but I don't know exactly what happened.
This Danish player, Christian Eriksen, he collapsed on the pitch. All right. Yeah, and ultimately, it was a cardio arrest, a proper heart attack. No, that's not. You know,
okay.
It was. That's what it was. And basically, they quickly, you know, the on-field doctor, etc., the players came around and they took him back. And he's okay at the moment. He's recovering and they're hoping full recovery will happen. So it's all good.
That's good.
But they were shattered. Football world was shattered. Players couldn't focus properly. The two supporters, and this is the good side of humanity, Finland and Danish guys going at each other till this incident happened, they started shouting. One, the Danes would shout Christian and the Finns would shout Eriksen. Kept chanting. No, that's lovely. You know, I love these stories. You know, at least you can see there's, you know, some appreciation for humanity. And it's really brought the football world and people who follow sports together because, you know, you really feel bad for a guy, like a young guy there collapsing on a pitch. And the game continued and everybody's had their comments about it. I, of course, and not to be insensitive, I was just thinking maybe the organizers thought, oh, heart attack. Thank God, not COVID. No, this is just my thought. I mean, don't, you know, propagate this. But because that's their big fear because they've gone all over Europe to avoid it, keeping them in small bags of groups of people, etc. But yeah, but let's hope he's okay. But the modern lifestyle, an athlete, a football athlete, world-class athlete, plays in the English Premier League as well, plays for Denmark. And yet, you know, has all the medical problems.
You never know.
Yeah, it didn't really happen, I think, in years gone by. Or maybe we just didn't notice it. But now lots of people in their 30s and late 20s and all are succumbing to heart issues and strokes and brain issues and all that, which is a little scary about where the world is turning. And this is an athlete, physical specimen, which is above, say, you and me,
right,
in terms of genetics.
Genetics and, I mean, like, you know, exercise, man. He probably exercised more in a day than...
But when genetics and exercise come together, you've got a guy who's got better health than you and me, generally speaking. But obviously not, in spite of training. They train like animals. for God's sake. They watch their diets, etc. He's as fit as he can get. And
yeah, no, it's hard, man. It's it is a very, very
mockery of the whole thing. You know, it's almost like whatever's going to happen is preordained sometimes, you know, and that people will keep telling you, stop smoking, stop drinking, watch this, watch the diet, blah, blah, blah. And then you see somebody like that falling and you're like, oof, what the hell? Might as well just, you know, go for it. But the good news is he'll be okay. So as of now.
That's good. Cool. Let me look for a couple of questions in here. Okay. So there's something from Shantanu Dubey. Azerbaijan used to have governors in medieval ages for 30 days. Do you think electing an MLA or MP for 5 years shuns the accountability? Do you think the terms are too long?
I absolutely agree. Amit, I'm sure you would love to dive into this.
No, I kind of agree as well.
I like the recall system. I feel the recall system really keeps them on their toes. Now, you might say too much power to the democracy and whatever, and the chance of the celebrities come back. But having said that, I think if you have a recall, maybe 30 days is too much, but maybe 6 months and a recall option. Because that means 6 months deliver. Give them a fair time, because 30 days is really not a fair time. 6 months.
Yeah. I would split the baby. I agree with what you're saying, right? I think that 5 years is too long a term. I think that 5 years allows, like, for not just interference, right? Think about this, right? We had a national election in 2019,
right?
The next national election is going to be in 2024,
right?
Is COVID going to be a criteria in that election 3 years from now?
Well, maybe, maybe not. If it's not, then that's all swept under the carpet.
Exactly. So
if by then the world has changed,
but it's a big deal, right? So I mean, like, I think that that should be a part of the election conversation that occurs
yearly. You're saying yearly.
Yearly might be, I would say every 2 years, maybe every 3 years, something like that. But 5 years feels long.
Logistically, you're saying because of cost to company, once every 2 years rather than once every 6 months. But I'm saying there must be a way to do more direct democracy sort of thing where we can, the cost can be a little more efficient. You don't have to stand out in numbers now that you're going to go online and stuff. Hmm. You know, like Switzerland does. Switzerland has rejected a tax increase for carbon dioxide. Okay, the carbon dioxide, in the sense, it's an anti-climate tax. What's the word? Anti-environment tax to help stop climate change, basically. So it's called a carbon dioxide law for what it's worth. They have direct democracy, like a referendum. Huh. So they basically rejected it. The tax going up, which was only meant to propagate awareness on climate change and how to fight it, right? So it's a good tax in a sense. They said, no, screw you, I don't want to do it. I'm telling you, you want Indians to pay tax? Let us be involved in tax validation from now only. Let's discuss it. And you see, suddenly we'll all do voting. The moment we can be in charge of all the tax laws.
At that point in time, yeah, of course.
Now you'll say you have to have an established adult democracy where people will think properly and it's a little scary or whatever. But I just think a recall should be in place because everywhere else the recall is in place. Our show gets cancelled if we don't work. You know, everything, whatever you do in life, you know, targets in a bank and in a corporate sector, wherever you are, small business, you've got to perform. So why not there? 5 years is like it's just a blanket to relax and then you say, chal, tu ja, 5 saal ke liye, phir main wapas aayega 5 saal ke baad. It's almost like they have an understanding sometimes.
So, you know, I mean, like, there is a flip side to the exact argument as well, right? That sometimes unpopular decisions need to be taken for the greater good. And it's a Republican government, it's not a Democratic government. We elect representatives. Representatives are supposed to make they're supposed to make decisions, not the direct people.
They are our government servants. That's the word, I just read it.
No, they are. They are our. They do answer to us, but they are our representatives, right? So the difference between direct democracy and republicanism, right, in that sense, is you in a republic, you elect people to decide to work for you. To work for you, and but then they apply their own judgment, right? In a direct democracy, the people make every choice.
That's why it's called direct. Now, but this direct and indirect, we understand that. Right. My point is, if you have the recall option, we stay with the indirect democracy module, our Republican government module. That's fine. To just give them a shorter area. That's it. So that they have to perform because they're on their toes now. Because Silvery, Amit and Cyrus will vote against them continuing because they've not been able to build the bridges. The infrastructure is terrible. The commerce, according to us, is bad. GDP has dropped. But what are the reasons? We've decided that we don't want to give you another chance. We're recalling you. Give the other guy a chance.
So I think shorter election terms are better. I don't like recalls. I've never been a fan of the recall system. I've never liked it in the U.S. I don't like it when they do it in California. I feel like it is it's just bizarre. It leads to bad behavior. It leads to a lot of gotchaism. I'm not a fan of the recall system, but shorter terms, 2-year, 3-year term. Because when you elect somebody, let them have some predictability about how much time they have.
Amit, let me decide this. Let me think properly when I'm relaxed after my massage, and I will decide what is good for India. If I don't decide, who will decide? All right, let's just take this on advice.
Fair point.
Let's do a quick last question.
Yes.
Because Silvery, your Wi-Fi sucks. Now you laughed at me. Wait. You laughed at me in Alibaba. In India. After how I try to put 5 phones together to create a satellite radio of my own to talk to people in Mars. You laughed. And then you laughed at me in Malwa Rail with the rich lane with Tere Paas Wi-Fi Day Gandu. Okay. Now explain to me what happened. Mr. Tech, explain to me what happened. Just call Dilip Lansley, your MLA, and explain to me. He's responsible for Wi-Fi. But right now, he's collecting garbage.
Yeah, correct. That's exactly what happened. Dilip Lande showed up and he disconnected my Wi-Fi. He's like, oh, you guys are talking ill about me. I control your area. I control your Wi-Fi. I'm going to cancel it.
But you're on a high floor, no? To throw garbage on a high floor.
Yeah. Dilip Lande was just here and he was like cursing us, basically.
Yeah. Without him, where will India go? We need him. Oh, in Maharashtra. Let's not, as Amit says, let's localize our situation.
Exactly.
Let's not bother. We're not going to cure Jabalpur's ills. We have to stay where we are. Okay, one more, sorry.
Okay, this one comes in from Spurti Venkatesh. She says, hey, Cyrus, Amit and Silvery, what is your favorite conspiracy theory? And if you guys start one with respect to Indian politics, what would it be?
But he hates conspiracy theories. He's almost like
I'm not a fan.
A conspiratationist, if that is the right word. Yeah. Google it fast. Yeah. And in fact, we argue about that all the time. And I say this could be the reason, that could be the reason, the underlying reason, and this layer and that layer, that it is crap out of it. There's no direct transfer of money from one bank to another. So, which is our favorite conspiracy theory? That's whatever. Think about.
So, which is the funnest conspiracy theory? I have an answer for
Kennedy.
That.
Kennedy will be your bugbear.
No, yeah. I mean, like, because again, see, all that stuff is, you have to really, really get into the. Larry Wilmore has this thing that he says, right? That to believe in a conspiracy theory, right? I mean, like, basically, you're demanding belief in the. You don't want to believe what is obvious, but you're demanding belief of the impossible as well, right? At the same time. And it's I like that formulation because what it tells me is that basically. The idea of something like a JFK, where there are a lot of questions, the idea is you have to actually debate it, right? So for me, the favorite ones are the ones which people just believe and are just like so nonsensical on the face of it, right? So flat earth theory is one of my favorite ones. I love when people believe the earth is flat. I love when people believe that, I love the astrology stuff, right? That to me, I mean, like, I don't know if that falls into a conspiracy theory.
We had a big fight over the moon landings. I'm telling you, it's possible because nobody went after 6 months for a long time. Well, they've gone now, but you know, but for 30 years, nobody went. So I'm talking about 69. What happened in 69?
Yeah.
Okay. This sounds vulgar. If you just look at me smiling, this what the hell's wrong? 69 is a year. It's also a year where you know lots of things happened in 1969. Okay, it threw us off topic.
Yeah, but it's the year that Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin landed on the moon.
Maybe not. Indian conspiracy. We'll come back to that one day.
Maybe not. They landed on the moon, dude.
Desi. He wants a Desi conspiracy.
Desi conspiracy.
Indian politics. So, there's one already about Prashant Kishore, Sharad Pawar and Prashant Kishore coming together now to form a pan-India party. They had lunch on Thursday somewhere. In fact, we saw the cars passing. So, we were the first to know in the Walkeshwar area when they were coming back from his office area, YB Chavan. So now the new conspiracy is that he's going to launch an all-party national party movement to take on, you know, almost like a coalition with a proper sort of, you know, rank and file.
Right.
Like a corporate structure that they'll have. And they'll already predispose who's going to be what and what so they don't have to fight after that. And then take on the BJP in 2024 with this new order.
That's interesting.
I don't know if conspiracy is the right word, but that's the whisper.
But that's actually it's an exciting possibility because it's not like the Congress is going to do a good job of taking on the BJP. So,
what other Indian conspiracy theories are there?
I don't know. What are there?
The Sachin Vase whole story is amazing. Just story wise, going by the story, the whole 200 crore restaurant thing also.
Oh, sorry, of Sushant Singh Rajput. Now, that's the conspiracy of all conspiracies. I mean, one actor, one performer, and one writer and newscaster came together and created, you know, a possible controversy out of nothing. And for 6 months, captured the imagination of Indian audiences and just spun tales.
Yeah, I think that's that's probably the one that's coming to my mind too, is like the most
active.
active, ridiculous followers, true believers, right? I mean, like, they really do believe that they are out to expose this stuff. So, I mean, like, yeah, I think that's a good one. I think the Sujan Singh Rajput one's a... I can't think of that many others, man. I'm struggling with...
There are minor superstitions which I can tell relate to a personal level. It's like my mother would not let me wear a black t-shirt for some reason. She presumed that black t-shirts bring bad luck. So for many years, I was forbidden. No, but these are conspiracy theories.
But isn't that more superstitions than conspiracy
theories? Yeah, I it was a leap of faith. I just got bored of the conspiracy. So to entertain Spruti, who appears to be a fine young lady, I decided to just go ahead with my black t-shirt conspiracy.
What about the, the India had all the technology in the past things. Does that fall into the conspiracy? The
flying vehicles. We discussed that with the author.
The flying vehicles, the stealth stem surgery, the nose jobs.
Yeah. But those are theories. That's a given. That's 100% given. We've got proof.
All right,
you don't challenge that proof, bro. Or send Dilip Landry to your house.
I know.
With 7 bags of garbage. Huh? Yeah, he can be quite cruel, I tell you. Okay.
What about freedom fighter type struggles, right? Like Mahatma Gandhi and Jawaharlal Nehru were responsible for Subhash Chandra Bose's plane going down because they felt like he was too much competition. Don't buy it in any way whatsoever. But, you know, that conspiracy does float around, right? Every so often.
That better conspiracy is that he survived everything. That story is, in fact, there's so many people who swear by it. They show pictures and this is him at 50 and 60 and blah, blah, blah. Which, again, makes no sense because why would he not appear?
Wasn't there a conspiracy also around Lal Bahadur Shastri's death?
Of course. How did that happen mysteriously? Blah,
there was
blah,
a
blah.
Movie made, right, recently
about that. Yeah. There's also a marg made in Ghatkopar called LBS Marg, which is a road, which brings us back to the beginning of this show.
It goes all the way to the Phoenix Mall, yes.
There you go. And we're coming back to the beginning of this show, where we started with the road collapsing and, you know, temper tantrums, etc. I think that's the end of the show. It's been fabulous. People are clapping wherever they're listening, any part of the world. In Amsterdam, we have two people who listen to our show, apparently. And so they are clapping and screaming like India's got a goal in the Euro Cup. My mom actually said this. I hope she doesn't see the show. Mom, we love you. But she actually said this. I'm not lying. I've done this gag in my written gag in the show, the TV show of ours. We're sitting on the dinner table, talking about the Euro Cup. And last week, and I said, Mom, so when is the opening game? So she said, Brazil and Argentina, I think, on Friday. Yeah, and my daughter went berserk. She does the ROFL, she acts it out. She falls and, you know, you know, just like that brocha malice to, you know, put you down when you've done something stupid and not let you forget it. Yeah, but it was really funny and innocently done, but it was real humor. And then later on, she was angry with me, you know, because of the ridicule that followed and said, but I'm right, it's Friday. I said, yeah, okay, Mom, it's Friday. And it was Friday. Friday was the... It just wasn't two South American countries playing, but it was definitely Friday, very much Italy, Turkey. All right. On that happy note, let's say bye-bye in the words of Karan Johar.
Okay, catch us on any of the podcasting apps, please. We beg you, we need you. Send us your questions on Twitter on Cyrus Says In, or you can email us, even if you're not female, on whatcyrussays@gmail.com.
If you love cricket, listen up. The Edges and Sledges Cricket Podcast is here for you. Hosted by DJ, Varun, and me, Ashwin, we bring a fun, fresh, fans' point of view to talking all things cricket. Sometimes it's just the three of us, sometimes we have guests, including current and former international cricketers. For new episodes every week, check out the Edges and Sledges Cricket Podcast on the IVM app, website, or wherever you get your podcasts.
We live in an age of disruption, of immense change in every aspect of work, life, and business. But is the old way of doing things truly dead? And are we ever going to stop saying the new normal? Join me, Varun Dugirala, on Advertising is Dead every Tuesday as I talk to entrepreneurs, leaders, creators, and change makers from across business, media, marketing, and beyond to dig a little deeper into how we got here, what we're doing now, and where we're headed. You can catch all the episodes of Advertising is Dead on the IBM Podcast website, app, or wherever you get your podcasts from.